Professor Deborah Vargas, who is presenting Chicana Borderlands, Sonic Imaginaries, a lecture in the Humanities Institute's Feminisms and the Radical Imagination series. Deborah Vargas is an associate professor and director of graduate studies in the Department of Ethnic Studies at the University of California, Riverside. Vargas is the author of Dissonant Divas in Chicana Music, The Limits of La Onda, which recently won the Woody Guthrie Prize awarded to the best book in popular music studies by the International Association for the Study of Popular Music. Dissonant Divas also received the award for Best Book in Chicano Studies, given by the National Association for Chicana and Chicano Studies, and also received the Distinction of Honorable Mention for Best Book in Latino Studies, awarded by the Latin American Studies Association. Vargas is the recipient of numerous fellowships awarded by the Ford Foundation, the Smithsonian Institution, the UC Humanities Research Institute, and the UC Office of the President. Finally, we would like to remind you to leave your surveys on your tables, and we will collect them after the event. During the lecture, you are also invited to tweet using the hashtag HISpring14. And now, let's give a warm welcome to Professor Deborah Vargas.
Thanks for that warm introduction. Good afternoon, everyone. I want to begin by extending a huge thanks to Professor Candida Yaquez, and the Humanities Institute for this wonderful invitation to this beautiful campus here at Scripps College. Also, thank you to Amy Emmert, I lost track, there you are in the back, for really working magic around all the logistics to bring me here around my visit. I really appreciate that my talk today is situated within the Institute's series, Feminisms and the Radical Imagination. Because as I have proposed in my book, Dissonant Divas in Chicana Music, the singers whose performances I analyze provide us with new questions, possibilities, and problematics for how we engage in, listen to, and make, grapple with and comprehend all aspects of what it means to make, listen, and move through musical imaginaries. Imaginaries that are never disconnected from systems of power, but that nonetheless sometimes give us flight, and sometimes, even if only for a fleeting moment, create new worlds previously unimaginable. I prepared my presentation on Dissonant Divas today with two goals in mind. First, this format allows us to hear some of the sounds that create what I refer to as Chicana Borderlands imaginaries. And second, while I can't go through the whole highlights of the book, I do want to feature three of the singers that I write about, Chelo Silva, Eva Garza, and Selena, to demonstrate their feminist queer musical dissonance within the canonical heteronormative imaginary of Borderlands music, what I call La Onda, or the Chicano sound wave. Based on a feminist queer analysis, I argue that normative constructions of heteromasculine gender, geography, and genre have upheld a dominant sonic imaginary of the borderlands in what our listening ears have come to understand as Chicano borderlands music. Such Chicana dissonant divas, I argue, reimagine the borderlands and borderland subjectivities through alternative geographies, ephemera, and queer performance, among others. I begin with two anecdotes that typify some of the experiences that have shaped my methodological journey in research and writing about these Chicana singers. Anecdote one. It's a hot, humid morning in Houston, Texas, in the post-Selena era. I am standing at the front door of the home of Lydia Mendoza, having arrived with Matt Watson, a sound engineer who's traveled from the Smithsonian in DC to record another installation of oral history interviews for the Latino Music Oral History Project. We're here because, since Selena's passing, the Smithsonian wants to add Mexican-American women singers to their oral history project. Mendoza's oral history represents the first Mexican-American woman to be added to this national project. Anecdote two. I've just completed a talk on Selena at a music symposium. After the panel ends, I chat with an audience member who wanted to follow up on a comment I made addressing the amount of critical analysis still left to be done on Chicana singers who came before Selena. He wanted to know who I thought was worthy of such attention. I rattled off several names. His response, "I've never heard of any of them. What did they accomplish? I mean, they're not Lydia Mendoza or anything." Lydia Mendoza and Selena have been symbolized. I forgot the slides, by the way. Okay, that's Mendoza and Selena. Lydia Mendoza and Selena have been symbolized in much popular and academic musicology as musical bookends of Mexican-American women singers of the 20th century. Both Mendoza and Selena have become not only the Chicana icons of Borderlands music, having garnered the most sustained references when popular media and music exhibits attempt to integrate the women in Chicano music. And while this attention is much deserved, such sustained critical inquiry almost exclusively on Mendoza and Selena represents what I refer to as a gendered politics of exceptional exemptions. In other words, the few women who are considered exceptional enough to represent the few exemptions to the rules of canonical historiographic practices. By extension, such logic has functioned not merely to sustain such reductive musical historiography, but also as a mechanism for reproducing what Chicano Borderlands music means and what has been convened for our listening ears. Chicano music is defined in my book as a musical form by and about Mexican descent peoples that convey historical narratives, cultural politics, and social identities. And that also functions as a means for staging alternative historical scripts and subjectivities in relationship to a US national imaginary. Its canonical construction is recognized and maintained by texts such as these and by specific musical figures, genres, and geographic parameters. For example, the Texas-Mexican sounds of accordion-driven conjunto music, rendered almost exclusively through masculinist nostalgia of rural regionality. There is also the genre of Chicano rock, highly dominated by West Coast historical analysis of the Los Angeles-based East Side sound, as well as through musical biographies of artists ranging from Richie Valens and Los Lobos to Santana. Arguably, one of the most iconic Borderlands sounds is that of corrido music, and its symbolic power demonstrated when the Smithsonian Institute chose it as the representative sound for a traveling exhibit that they did on Mexican American history. By extension, I engage Chicano music in the ways it forms sonic imaginaries for Mexican descent peoples, whose social identities and subjectivities are shaped in relationship to, but not exclusively, by the systems of power within the United States. I understand a sonic imaginary as a musically sounded or sonic field where people come to understand, contest, relate, and remake notions of belonging, history, place, and cultural sensibilities. Moreover, the notion of sonic imaginaries in my book is analytically approached according to Alicia Schmidt Camacho's theorizations of social imaginaries. Social imaginaries, she argues, quote, approaches cultural forms not as a reflection of the social, but rather the means by which subjects work through their connections to a larger totality and communicate a sense of relatedness to a particular time, place, and condition, end quote. I argue thus that during the 20th century, musical compilations, folklore studies, and public cultural histories, including documentaries such as Songs of the Homeland, museum exhibits, cinematic narratives such as La Bamba and the Ballad of Gregorio Cortez, have produced a dominant heteronormative sonic imaginary of Chicano Borderlands music that has relied on the elision as well as reductive gender analysis of Chicana singers whose dissonant voices and illegible representations have gone unheard and misheard. In Dissonant Divas, I frame my inquiries and analysis through a queer feminist framework I refer to as musical dissonance that works against simply making previously unheard and discursively inharmonious female voices and life stories audible and legible, but rather argues that listening through what has activated their illegibility and inaudibility within canonical productions of music has the potential to propel alternative Chicana Borderlands sonic imaginaries, that is, soundings of the Borderlands as articulated by Chicana feminist cultural studies theorists, as an historical geopolitical space, as a trope for subjectivities in flux, and as insistently queer. As such, considering the sonic Borderlands imaginaries created by these singers requires complicating what is understood as music, what assembles music history, and what is left out of music-making moments by simultaneously engaging the experiential narratives that are too often left offstage and off-page. Indeed, the musical figures I analyze represent gender and sexuality subjectivities that are counter to, in excess of, and incompatible with the normative historiography that has held up La Onda of Chicano music. Thus, listening through the dissonance of these singers, that is, through the very canonical methodologies that have rendered them indiscernible, means rigorously engaging music through promiscuous acts, the non-empirical recollections, and the seemingly incompatible geographic places where they have remained in endless, inaudible rotation. There is perhaps no better musical example of the power of heteromasculine gender in the sonic imaginary of La Onda than that of corrido music, discursively configured through battles over territory, interethnic conflict, and what Ramon Saldivar refers to as subaltern Mexican-American opposition to Anglo-American state apparatuses and assimilationist pressures. Corrido studies holds such a prominent place in the canon of Chicano music that it is arguably, it has held the most sustained recovery and analytic attention by music and folklore scholars. Moreover, no other scholar has come to exemplify the corrido more eminently than Américo Paredes, who would in fact come to identify the corrido as a musical narrative device and more precisely as the border ballad of Greater Mexico. By extension, any scholarly engagement, public exhibit, or historical narrative of corridos in relation to Mexican descent peoples have had to move through what Chicano scholars have deemed the most influential book in Chicano cultural studies. That is Paredes's book, With His Pistol in His Hand, A Border Ballad and Its Hero, a folklore analysis of the corrido, the ballad of Gregorio Cortez about the heroic figure who stood up against the Texas Rangers. So strong is this link between author, corrido scholarship, and the production of Chicano heroic subjectivities that at times Paredes himself becomes a later 20th century academic version of Cortez. And this is exemplified in a quote by academic theorist José Limón. He states, Mr. Paredes has and his book become like a corrido and a hero for a new generation of Chicano social activists of the 60s who recognize the legendary fighting qualities of two men, Cortez and Paredes. And there were many times during the writing and researching of Silva that I attempted to try to tune out Paredes's grand presence in my life as in Silva's life. Yet I continually found Paredes inescapable in telling her story. What I finally understood was that making sense of Silva's musical dissonance in Chicano music wasn't about silencing Paredes, but about maneuvering my way through the echoes of this corrido masculinity, just as Silva had done her entire life. Consuelo Chelo Silva was born the eldest daughter of seven children in Brownsville, Texas in 1922. A gifted vocalist from a very young age, Silva garnered great attention locally for her strong vocals and what is described as her mastery of sustaining and substantiating each song with depth and realism. What Mexican songwriter Emma Elena Valdelamar once defined as a distinction between a singer and an interpreter of song. In the late 1930s, a young Silva would garner the attention of a local notable in Brownsville, the host of a local program called El Músico y Poeta, or the musician and poet. His name was Américo Paredes. Paredes's radio show offered the young Silva a popular media circuit for her singing, and the musical fusion of Paredes and Silva on radio would result in a passionate personal union, one that would result in marriage the very same year they met in 1939. Silva would bear Paredes's first son and namesake, Américo Paredes Jr., but the marriage would end a few years later. The rupture of their union was a symbolic prelude to the unique journeys that each would take. As Ramon Saldivar explains in his book, Paredes wanted to develop and amass his own original repertoire. Silva's desire was to explore broader musical horizons, perform songs by other composers, and tour with other bands. Chelo Silva, it seemed, was not going to offer either the consolation or comfort promised by her name. Paredes, in turn, was not able to deal with a woman like Silva. And Silva's sister, Angelica, would concur with such statements, saying once in an interview, he was a power, but he couldn't contain her. As Borderlands subjects, Silva and Paredes came to literally produce and discursively embody two cultural modes of Borderlands knowledge production, the bolero and the corrido. Silva chose the microphone, Paredes chose the pen. After going their separate ways, Silva's musical career along the US-Mexico border, as well as throughout various parts of Mexico, rose to high status. Paredes' musical aspirations declined to the point that he soon ceased to perform. As sonic texts, the bolero and corrido offer distinct configurations of power and empowerment. The corrido conveys modes of cultural resistance, while the bolero finds flight from the material realities of the present through lyrics filled with dramatic romantic betrayals and non-gender specific desires. If, as Ramon Saldivar has argued, that corridos represent social symbolic texts that engage readers in alternative reconstructions of Texas border history, then what histories may we ponder in other musical forms that have remained in the echoes of Paredes' life narrative and knowledge production? What I learned about attempts to make sense of Silva's life while frustratingly moving through awkward silences and rumors during interviews was that a different border ballad has been here all along, recording histories and making imaginaries. My chapter proposes that Silva's boleros be considered her border ballad, an alternative narrative device for considering power as conflict, struggle, and resistance, configured not merely through battles over geographic territory, heroic masculine deeds, and racial subordination, but as border ballads that illuminate, for example, the politics of racialized women's bodies as also colonized territories, and that understands racial subordination as never not gendered and sexualized. What might we find in a borderlands imagined through Silva's ballad? Perhaps that vessels are as power-ridden as bullets, that there is truth in what is not said, and that the power of music is not so much in its function as a mode of resistance, but perhaps as a mode of submission to unspeakable desires and sexual acts. Such is the case in this performance I want to share, where Silva profoundly sings in response to questions and rumors about her life. If you want to know what has become of my life, then just ask me. Thank you. hard transition, sorry. This would be Chelo Silva's last live performance and exemplifies, as you've just heard, all of the inappropriateness that has been too irreverent for the master narratives of Chicano music. Silva's performance of Pregúntame a mí both represents the power of her songbook in conveying a border ballad that refuses normative Chicana womanhood, as it simultaneously conveys the power of bolero performance as her sonic apparatus for responding to endless innuendo and rumor that plagued her life. Learning to listen for Chicana singers has taken me to numerous places, metaphorically and geographically, that I did not expect. Working my way through and around Chicano music's vato vernacular, that is, the played out dude talk of narratives concerned with who was who and who did what, with hardly any attention to gender and sexuality as systems of power, taught me a great deal about the quotidian ways gender and sexuality politics played out for these singers as they navigated through structural systems of difference to find a gig and to fulfill their joys and desires for performing. Thus, the methodologies for my own tellings and analyses of their stories and cultural labor was not a concern with shoring up their incompleteness or cleaning up the contradictions of their life choices. Rather, I attempted to honor the passion that they put into their songs by trusting the excursions their music would take me on. Such was the journey of my learning to listen for the music of a South Texas Chicana in a place and through voices I never imagined.
Tienen tus ojos cuando me miras. Sabor de engaño siento en tus labios cuando me besas. No eres sincero en tus ojos cuando me miras.
Mira, ahorita.
Ay, si me gustaba mucho, yo me la sé.
Por engaño tienen tus labios cuando me besan.
Esa pegó muy fuerte aquí en la canción.
No eres sincero cuando me dices que aún me amas. En tus palabras se nota el olvido de la traición.
Mira, esta es su foto de ella.
Imposible seguir un juego de esa manera. Te agradezco por el alma. que aún me quieres, si en tus palabras se nota el filo de la traición. No es posible seguir viviendo de esta manera. Yo te agradezco con todo el alma tu noble empeño y te prometo portarme fuerte cuando me digas que no me amas, que es para otra tu corazón. Que no me amas, que es para otra tu corazón. Yo estoy también
I arrived in La Habana, Cuba, following Eva Garza's fragmented narratives based on family memories and pieces of discographies that I compiled across the U.S. Southwest in Mexico. What I knew from her sister, Tina, was that Garza made her initial visit to Cuba in 1946 and would live in La Habana for 7 years, for months at a time, performing under various contracts. What I learned about Garza on my journey to La Habana and about methodologies of listening for Chicano music exceeded my research plan. Flora and Carmen featured here in my very low-tech video production that I take great pleasure in describing as failed ethnography reminded me quite profoundly that locating Eva Garza was not about looking in the right places and asking the right questions, but about going to the seemingly wrong places and listening to the supposedly wrong people. That is, embracing the multiple sonic registers through which Garza's songs are still making Borderlands music. It was nearly 6 decades since Garza recorded Sabor de Engaño, or Taste of Betrayal, that would become one of her biggest bolero hits in the early 1950s. Sabor de Engaño recounts the temporalities of love and deceit, of lingering pains requiring closure, as the lyrical protagonist directly engages the deceitful lover and instead of offering forgiveness insists on an end to their union, yet an end that would bear the endless lingering taste of betrayal. It seemed no matter who I queried, from hotel staff to Cuban musicologists, the name Eva Garza did not initially trigger descriptions of great vocals or remarkable performance. Rather, what her name did immediately bodily retrieve were the lingering lyrics that remain Garza's musical testimony in Cuba. I chose to begin my chapter on Garza with her life narrative in La Habana because it is precisely a beginning, a place most dissimilar to the geographies of the US Southwest and West Coast that have sustained the sonic parameters of Chicano borderlands imaginaries. This non-normative beginning illuminates the geographic parameters that shape Eva Garza's musical dissonance. Rather than representing missing pieces to a linear historical narrative, my research of Garza revealed the necessity to engage her subjectivity and musical sound through a non-linear listening analytic, one that conveys a borderland sonic imaginary alternative to the South to North Mexican migration models dominant in Chicano musicology and sociology. Informed by Chicano cultural studies and borderlands theory, I extend Jose David Saldivar and Sonia Saldivar Hull's notion of transfrontera, defined as a geopolitical space in which Mexican descent peoples manufacture new social relations, cultural productions, and border contact zones, thereby challenging dominant national centers of identity and culture. I draw from this to establish a Chicana feminist listening analytic that I refer to as a transfrontera musical compass, an analytic that refuses listening through the reproduction of heteronormative spatial temporal logics that have sealed Chicano music along a south to north geographic axis through a musical historiography almost entirely demarcated by the US-Mexico border and as one dominated by tropes of territorialization and class resistance. Listening to Garza's music and life stories through a transfrontera musical compass designates a feminist analysis of Garza's music and life narratives along multiple spatial temporalities where she has remained unheard. This spatial temporal compass charts Garza's musical life through various incongruent times and places, what Mary Pat Brady refers to as those spatial temporal moments that disrupt national borders and national imaginaries as fixed in time. A transfrontera musical compass encourages new soundings of Chicano borderlands imaginaries that direct attention to Garza's transnational bolero sphere constituted by cinematic circuits recording and radio performance through the musical hubs of New York City, Mexico City, and various parts of Cuba, and through radio broadcasts originating from XEW and XEQ in Mexico City that early on often reached radio listeners as far north as the US Southwest. To be sure, Garza's voice was not exceptional or unique or supreme in the manner required of musicians and singers who became the masters that usually garner one's entry into a canonical music history. Rather, the power of Garza's Chicana musical subjectivity and vocals is in its insistence that the musical public, the historian, the researcher, submit to misdirected sounds, to trust the unpredictable ways performances and recordings make possible the production of borderland sonic imaginaries that have life in seemingly dissimilar geographic zones, imaginaries that sound against the heteronormative geographies of Chicano musical comunidad and homeland. It is my hope that Dissonant Divas not only illuminates alternative sonic imaginaries by considering the lives and music of relatively unacknowledged singers, but also by listening differently to those that we may assume to know too well. In other words, listening in ways that unsettle the normalized race and gender discourses that uphold a very rigidly constructed canonical imaginary of borderlands music. Our listening ears, in other words, have been taught quite well to comprehend music and the gender performances and social identities constructed through overdetermined racialized class and gender projects of Chicano musical genres. And such is the case with the now oversaturated sounds of Selena. When Selena was tragically killed in 1995, I was struck as a fan of her music by how US-based English language music journalists and news media attempted to make sense of this English-speaking young brown woman who was raised in a small coastal city along the Gulf of Mexico. Almost immediately, the racialized discourse of the Tex-Mex music genre that deemed her reina or queen came to define Selena's relevance as an almost American success story through the musical notion of crossover. Selena's crossover, the notion of moving discreetly from one musical form to another, from one language to another, from one kind of listening audience to another, would in fact be the cinematic narrative arc chosen by Gregory Nava in his Hollywood production of Selena the movie. And this crossover, of course, was the CD Dreaming of You, right, that was posthumously released. Rebbe Garofalo, among other African American music scholars, has proposed that the discourse of musical crossover is one that depends on the homogeneous reductive racialization of music genres. By extension, for Spanish language singing subjects racialized as Mexicano or Latino or Chicano, or in the case of Selena as La Reina del Tex-Mex, crossing over requires the maintenance of a Tex-Mex genre reliant on reductive racialized discourses of gender, language, and an El Sur to El Norte linear musical migration model. I propose instead that we listen to Selena again, to her sonic imaginary that I refer to as Brown Soul, Selena's African diasporic or black sound, as one never delinked from her queer of color sensibility. Selena's Brown Soul unsettles the structural systems of racial discourse that have upheld Chicano music as persistently eliding blackness. Put simply, Selena's Brown Soul sonically imagines the borderlands as activated through African diasporic sound. In other words, the idea that Selena was on the verge of crossing over through her CD Dreaming of You relies on the simultaneous reduction of a Chicana singing subject to Spanish language, as well as the notion of English language pop music as already not black. My analysis of Selena's Brown Soul brings to the fore the echoes of African diasporic music that are central to Selena's distinct sound and performance aesthetics, especially through what would become her classic cumbia moves. I propose that thus Selena's diverse musical repertoire, moving from Spanish language ballads and cumbias to freestyle and R&B ballads, such as those in her posthumous CD, Dreaming of You, are not discrete or progressive moves towards an English language American musical crossover. Rather, they are musics propelled by and that enact black sonic imaginaries. And to be sure, while there are numerous examples of Chicano music and dance studies that analyze Chicano music's melding or fusion with, for example, African-American derived jazz and blues, you know, as melding or as a fusion with Chicano music, these kinds of models, I think, still mostly read black music, African-American derived music, black sound as merely influences, right, or cultural exchanges, sort of on the edge of the music itself. And what I mean by this is that the musical nation-making projects of Mexicanidad and by extension Chicanidad have operated as if blackness sounds merely at the limits rather than as Chicano borderlands imaginaries. So for instance, with regards to Selena's cumbias, Deborah Pacini Hernandez reminds us that the cumbia as an Afro-Colombian music belongs to a broader body of music that emerged from the dance band arrangements of Afro-Colombian music styles on the Atlantic coast in the mid-1930s and 1940s. Yet in its Mexican and even Chicano transformations over the 20th century, black sound disappears in the historical discourses of cumbias, especially as cumbias move further north through Mexico and into the US Southwest during the 20th century. Thus, listening to Selena's brown soul, such as Tecnocumbia, right, that is arguably one of, if not the earliest cumbia to include rap lyrics, takes us on a metaphoric musical U-turn, whereby the circulation of her cumbias across Mexican America, throughout Mexico, and further south even, are not merely in conversation with black music, but rather her cumbias should be engaged as African diasporic sonic movements across the Americas. Her cumbias, como La Flor, Amor Prohibido, and La Carcacha, among many others, moved Selena across unimagined Tex-Mex genre geographies, just as her cumbias moved brown bodies against the racial, gender, and sexual limits of Chicano music. Selena's brown soul thus requires a different engagement with these musics, one that allows us to conceive of the interconnectedness between a cumbia like Bitty Bitty Bum Bum and an R&B ballad like Missing My Baby. In other words, such a borderlands imaginary activated by Selena's brown soul conveys that for Selena, a Spanish language Afro-Mexican son jarocho like La Bamba and freestyle music and dance actually make total black sense. I want to exemplify this point through a very brief segment of Selena's initial performance in Mexico. And I apologize ahead of time for the very grainy quality. It was back during the VHS days of recording. This performance in Mexico was part of the Johnny Canales show, so just to provide some context. This was a really big deal at that time, particularly in the 80s and 90s, for any Spanish language music artist. It was, for those of us in my generation who still remember American Bandstand, it was like American Bandstand. For the rest of you born a few years ago, maybe American Idol would be sort of like that equivalent of a stage. And hopefully what you can make out through the graininess is, of course, a very young and very 80s styled Selena y Los Dinos attempting to register with their first live Mexican audience by performing their rendition of the iconic song La Bamba, albeit a very freestyle cover of it. And hopefully, for those of you who know freestyle music or maybe fans, you'll recognize some of the percussion breaks, which is very typical in freestyle, and of course, Selena's dance moves. So hopefully this comes through. There. La Bamba was the second song on their playlist for this performance. And the next clip is of the song that Selena y Los Dinos actually opened with in their debut before this live Mexican audience. And of course, a broader audience that was watching on the Johnny Canales show. I play these in reverse order because I want to emphasize that Selena's Spanish language music is never disconnected from black sound. Put simply, Selena's brown soul propels a borderlands imaginary that does not perpetuate blackness as distinct from or merely fused with borderlands music. Who recognizes the song, any? Okay. Jody Watley's I'm Looking for a New Love not only precedes La Bamba, I argue, it sonically prescribes La Bamba. In other words, this playlist sounds brown soul, and what I mean by this is that I'm Looking for a New Love, followed by the freestyle version of La Bamba, requires that we listen to the African diasporic sounds of Selena's music, especially her cumbias, that moreover, I argue, were never distinct or should never be understood as distinct from her English language R&B ballads, you know, the crossover move, supposedly, that she makes in Dreaming of You. And this, I argue, is the dissonance that's produced when simply reducing Dreaming of You to crossover music. In other words, Selena's brown soul disrupts the black-white, English-Spanish, U.S.-Mexico binaries that sustain crossover discourse. Her brown soul thereby propels an alternative borderlands imaginary that remaps Chicana musical subjectivity through black sound. Hearing Selena's brown soul insists that we reckon with the power of rigid, racialized constructions of Chicano music and rather move with her to imagine black diasporic soundings of the borderlands. In the research that I've conducted, too many Chicana singers are ever present, yet too out of place, and in too many fragments to fit a normative temporality of musical citizenship and homeland. Metaphorically, such Chicana performers are out of time and out of place for normative legibility in la onda of Chicano borderlands music. Their music and life narratives push the sonic limits of canonical music projects that have come to constitute Chicano musical sound through heteronormative genealogies of family, a gendered telos of cultural resistance, and through empirical notions of musical archives. I want to close my talk by sharing the first day I ever listened to Eva Garza, because this experience persistently grounded the political stakes as well as the methodological challenges I encountered in writing about these dissonant divas. Eva Garza entered my sonic orbit of borderlands music during one of the many days I had spent conducting an oral history interview with singer Rita Vidaurri in San Antonio. She expressed to me that no music research of mine would be complete without learning of Eva Garza. She says, "She passed away a long time ago, but I can call her sister for you." After Vidaurri placed a call to Garza's sister, Tina Moore, she gave me Moore's address, and I accepted it with some hesitation, because at this time I was a very overly confident graduate student who at that time, you know, I thought I knew everything there was to know about borderlands music. I showed up to Moore's home the next day. After knocking on the front door for a few minutes, she opened it, and without even asking my name, said, "Hi, I'm Tina. I've been waiting for you to listen to my sister's story. Come in. Scattered across Moore's kitchen table was an amazing archive that she had held together with scotch tape and Elmer's glue, assembled in photo albums, stashed in shoeboxes, and squeezed into manila envelopes. There was Eva Garza, suspended in time, narrated through various fragments of ephemera, in every place and yet so out of place, configuring a borderland sonic imaginary waiting for someone to listen. Thank you.